independent project work. This is a tough question, isn't it? What independent projects should you do to get real-world experience and to get your resume and your profile noticed so that you can land your first job in the field? The reason why a lot of projects don't get you there is because they're one-dimensional. So what I want to walk you through today is what a full project in the real world looks like. And I'm going to give you 18 different aspects and categories for a real world project. Now, you don't have to do every single one of them in your project. And in some cases, you may want to do one, but not do the full write-up or the full research and development of one of those aspects. However, you want to be cognizant of them. And you want to think about maybe paying it a little lip service, talking about how in the real world, this is how you would have done it, but this is one of your independent projects, so maybe it wasn't feasible, or maybe it just something that didn't apply in this case. You didn't have time to do it. But still, acknowledge it, and your project is going to be more comprehensive and more real world. It's going to give a hiring manager more confidence that you can actually do the job, and you stand out so much more when you have practical, applied, real world focused projects in your portfolio. These are the types of things that I look at and think, wow, that's someone I want to bring in and give a chance to. So let me dive right in. So the first piece is building a data science business case. You don't typically do this with independent projects, and most boot camps or even sometimes your master's degree may not properly explain what a business case is. It's the reason why you're doing this. What would the business expect from this project? And why? What problem are you solving? That's actually the next aspect, talking about the business problem. What is a data science business problem? And those two are going to get sandwiched into this very introductory project that's going to explain and lay out the case for everything you do afterwards. And it's so much more applied when there's a one-pager that explains this is what, in a business setting, this sort of project could accomplish. These are the practical implications of this thing that I'm going to do, and here are some real-world constraints and considerations, talking about the user, talking about revenue or cost savings. How would this benefit a business? In what scenarios would a business ask you to do this? Think about markets. Think about the business. And your project is going to be so much more focused and so much more of a, wow, this makes sense from someone like me who's reading it, because now I have a basic understanding of why you did what you did and why you made some of the decisions that you made. So that's huge. Another piece of this is part three, requirements gathering. You may not have users. In some master's programs and in some boot camps, you actually get to work on real world projects, which is awesome. You'll get requirements, and that's huge. But if you're doing this independently, you have to put yourself in the chair of the user, or even better, talk to some people who might be users of what it is that you're building and ask them, so if you were specifying this to me, how would you need it to work? What realities would I have to take into account in order to build something that isn't just functional, doesn't just work, it works in a practical way that a user would be able to adopt? That's huge. It makes a project feel real. And again, you're convincing me as a hiring manager that you can actually do this job, that it's not like this hypothetical thing that you don't really understand. You're ready for prime time. That's extraordinarily important. Now, when you frame a problem, obviously, what are you going to have to do next is frame the solution. Now that you have all of this background written up, you have your requirements, you know why you're doing this project and the problem that you're trying to solve. Now, explain the solution. This is important at the very beginning of a project to talk through what it is that you're going to build. Don't just kind of hit at it ad hoc, because I feel that in projects. I'll look at a project and just go, okay, so you just threw stuff at a wall and got lucky that one thing fit and one thing actually worked. Don't do that. Call your shots. Say, hey, this is what I'm going to do. And sometimes that means it doesn't work. And that's fine. Sometimes your solution, your definition of your solution changes and evolves. And the next piece of the project, which is your feasibility study, is a huge part of that. So you've called your shot. You've said, hey, I'm going to solve this problem and here's the solution. I've defined out the solution, what I think I need. Now you look at it and say, is this feasible? Can you gather the data? Do you actually have access to reliable data that fits in with your solution? Do you have the resources you need in order to build this? Do you have the capabilities yourself? Is this something that's feasible? Can you do this? This is very real world. Again, convincing me that you're thinking so much more completely about a solution than a whole lot of the people that you're going to be competing with for those same jobs. You stand out immediately with this part of the project that most people don't even take into account. So write it up. Think about it like it's a real world thing. Now next, connecting your business metrics to your model metrics. This goes back to the business case. So every time your model gets more accurate, every time your model does something more efficiently or is able to function, what does that mean to the business? What does accuracy mean? What does the quality of inference impact? Real world results. What does it drive? So make that connection. If I improve accuracy by N, this is the value it produces. Maybe it's more money. Maybe you're able to target customers in a more granular way. Something like that is a real world impact. Maybe the dashboard being more accurate, maybe the analytics going from descriptive analytics to predictive and prescriptive is going to provide an ability for the business to compete better. Think about those and then tie your model metrics to your business metrics. Make it real. Make any improvement worth some amount of value to the business. Make that tangible connection. Now you may have technical requirements, and this is probably going to come out of your feasibility study. What kind of pipeline do you need to build? What platform do you need to enable your development and potentially deployment and support? This is, again, it makes it a real world problem, and your thinking, your thought process is now standing out to me because you're not just thinking about this as I build model, I'm done. You've explained why, you've connected me to the business, you've talked to users, and you're considering the fact that there's someone that will actually use this. And now you're talking about all of the things that you need to prepare in order to actually accomplish this project. You're also going to talk about your workflow and thought process for how you deliver value. It's huge. Stands out so much when someone does that. Now, the next thing is massive, even bigger than all of this stuff that we've been talking about. The biggest piece that's missing from most projects is a real-world data set. You start with one in many cases, especially with smaller independent projects. You're going to start with one data set. But I want you to understand in the real world, the data sets that we get, we have to a lot of times build ourselves, curate ourselves. We get garbage and we have to deal with the reality of that garbage. You want to put yourself in the same spot. You want to showcase your ability to source data, to go out and find it. Not a canned data set like you would find on Kaggle or something like that. But you're finding, sourcing data. You've gone out and you've discovered an interesting data source that will solve the problem. And all of that stuff that you've described up until now is going to help you find that data set. So there's some interesting places that you can find data. Governments release tons and tons of data sets. You can find them there. Anytime a big company is investigated or is involved in a lawsuit, this may sound a little weird, but the media will release a lot of the data that has to be made public as part of that lawsuit. And so you can find a lot of data there. Academia researchers will often publish large data sets. And those are simpler to work with because they are better curated. Although you're probably going to have to do some adopting it and wrangling to get it to work for your particular use case. So be real. Find a data set and make that effort to find and source data, to clean it, and to acknowledge the real world of ugly data and how you manage that. How do you deal with that problem, or typically a lot of problems, that come with real world, ugly, unstructured, sometimes data sets? So you now have this real world thing, this real data that you've curated, and that's project 9. We're all the way to 9. Can you believe that? That you've curated, that you've built, that you have cleaned and made ready for model development. And with every data set, turn it into an analytics project. This is huge. Even if you don't go any further than this, even if you get to the end of this and you just go, this just isn't feasible. I couldn't get the right data. I couldn't make this data work with the model. You're going to at least have something, which is an analytics project. And that means that you go through the data, you get some interesting insights. Find something that's not generic about the data. Bring something forward that's insightful. And then project 11, data visualization and presentation. Just do a write-up and do some interesting visualizations with it. Display your capabilities of showing data to a number of different audiences using visualization and helping them take away from your presentation something novel, something insightful, something interesting. That's massive. That is a massive capability, and you stand out. Again, another way for you to stand out is, it doesn't sound like a complex project, but when I see someone who can communicate using visualizations, potentially in written format, maybe you tape a video, like I'm taping a video, and you do your data visualization off to the side and you do sort of a mock presentation, that's real. Now I have a connection with you and your capabilities. I have a better understanding of what you can do. That's way, way past anything I'm going to get from a resume. That's awesome. Now, if you've done that basic analytics project and you see, because I mean, you're going to have to explore data before you build a model anyway, right? If you've done that and you decide, okay, this is not only feasible, but it's practical. I'm going to move forward. This is the kind of project that I want to put in my portfolio. So you build your data pipeline, probably remedial. You're probably just pulling data from a service. That's fine. Build a pipeline, do a real basic write-up of your discovery, of your gathering, how you actually built the pipeline that gathers the data, maybe how you're hitting the API, where you're storing it, and so on. Talk about your transformation. Typically part of wrangling is transforming the data in one way, shape, or form. Sometimes you have to aggregate it from multiple sources. If you have to do any annotation, write up your methodologies around annotating data. So, I mean, it's basic data engineering. Then obviously you have your sampling, your serving, and those are going to be your main components of the data pipeline. Write it up. And like I said, the way I described it sounds kind of complicated, but you know it isn't. Data pipelines are pretty easy when you're doing independent project work, a lot more complicated in the real world. But if you talk about it using the same workflow and framework, you're going to sound more applied and more capable. Now, this is the part that most people do as part of their project, which is the training, evaluation, selection, and validation. Don't forget validation. Remember, you're probably comparing multiple models against each other, and that's the key to selection. You want to use a few different architectures against each other, and a great way to approach this is look at a research paper that's, you know, recent within the last year that claims to be good at solving the problem that you're solving versus a couple of other approaches, and then reproduce that. Try those canned approaches and then implement the paper, because typically they come with code, and so your implementation isn't going to be that difficult. Compare them, and that's a huge result. Those are amazing projects where you're basically going back and doing the same thing that the people that wrote the paper did. You're validating their results, which is very significant. We do that a lot. That's real world, because you've taken a paper, you've implemented it, but it's an easy implementation because you have a framework from the GitHub repo associated with that paper. They'll publish code, like I said. So you can take that, you can implement it. You'll have to do a little bit of tweaking and a little bit of customization in order to get it to work for your particular scenario. And then your results can be, they were right. Their approach is better than XYZ, and I did it against this. Those are amazing projects. You hear it, right? You're hearing how much more you stand out just doing a little bit more. It's not that much more, even though it sounds, 18 sounds overwhelming. But you can hear how a lot of these can be abbreviated, how you can focus on the ones that are more important and more relevant to the project that you've selected and even the role that you're targeting. But you're so much more practical. You're so much more applied. It seems more professional and polished, doesn't it? Now, don't forget that validation. Validation is the beginning of sort of your quality phase, and that's the next part of the project that I want to talk about. Validation happens on a different data set. Gather new data or put this thing into the real world and see how it actually performs. And that's, again, going on past quality. You want to test internally. You want to test it before you deploy it. Obviously, it's got to work. It has to, as an accuracy standpoint, work. You want to compare it to some sort of, you know, almost guessing. You want to have some solution that's hard-coded. Maybe you put some business logic in place and see how your model performs versus something that's serving, I don't know, like an expert system, really. Make sure that you've actually discovered something. Make sure that your model actually works better than guessing or better than some fairly simplistic solution. So you validate to me as a hiring manager that you didn't just shove this model out the door without testing it and without validating it, that you put some work into this and you can, with a level of confidence, say to me, I found something, this model actually works. It does something in production. And now finally deploy it. Get it out there. Let it work. Let it be real. It's amazing when you can show someone a deployed model, how much of a reaction you get out of a hiring manager, because I know you can do an end-to-end project now. Why? I'm seeing it. I'm staring at it. I can go and look at this thing serving inference in the real world, or I can look at your write-up of this thing actually working in the real world. That's amazing. That's so much more professional than a lot of the toy projects that you typically come across. And finally, you know, if you have the opportunity to, if it's running in production or in the real world for long enough, monitor it and think about continuously improving it. As you learn, if this is a project that you did early on in your education, think about and coming back to it and improving it and talking about, hey, I revisited this 3 months later and I found a couple of different, and then write up, what did you do? How did it improve? What did you, based on that learning, now apply to make this project better? That's huge. Learn, apply is something that all of us, when we're hiring, are looking for. And so think about that. Bring in new concepts and new things that you've learned and do things like continuous retraining. Maybe even do a little bit of ML ops. It's not hard. There's tons of platforms out there that will make this side of the world really, really easy. They're all open source. You'll have to do some legwork to implement them, but that's it. And then you have this, I mean, think about it. That's like a real project, isn't it? I just walked you through in 18 steps, a real project. Again, don't feel like you have to do every single step. And if you touch on every single step, remember, some of them can be a paragraph or two that you just write up. Not everything is going to be perfectly real world, and that's okay. And you can even acknowledge that. You can say, look, this is a, this is an independent project. And so this is how I did it because, you know, from a feasibility standpoint, that's all I had. But if I were working in a business, this is probably the process that I would have followed to do it better. Always come back to things and try to tweak it and fix it and make it better, and then just write that up. So think about projects in this framework, this massive, wide, real-world, business-focused framework, and you're going to stand out. You're going to seem like someone who's capable. And instead of doing a dozen of these small, toy, you know, generic data sets where we've all seen these projects and they don't give me as a hiring manager a level of confidence that you really know how to do this job, do one, maybe two, really comprehensive, complete end-to-end projects, and then write them up, describe what you did, and you have so much that you can share, especially on social media. You can share your entire journey through this and give me as a hiring manager a rich body of work that I can look at that goes beyond your resume. Now you come into an interview with me expecting you to be competent rather than me worrying that you're blowing smoke. So focus on making your projects real world and incorporate all of these elements in a small way or in a big way to make yourself stand